got by the Mysterons. The baddies from Captain Scarlett, just one of the extracts you're going to enjoy in this, the second of our trips back to watch some of the best children's programmes of the 60s, 70s and 80s. This time, it's the 70s. Amongst the favourites, we've got for you Tiswas, Swap Shop, The Tomorrow People, Playaway, Rainbow, and The Wombles. But first, back to Captain Scarlett.
Leading the fight, one man fate has made indestructible. His name, Captain Scarlett.
There it is. We found him. Relay that position to all Spectrum personnel. Order the nearest Angel to try and make visual contact.
Yes, sir.
Proceed to area reference 3DN. Captain Black is believed to be in this vicinity. Seek and report.
FIG.
Our latest information indicates that Captain Black should reach your checkpoint in approximately 2 minutes.
What sort of vehicle is he driving?
We have no confirmation.
But it could be Spectrum Pursuit Vehicle 0782.
I have visual contact with SPV 0782.
It's heading south along Highway 74.
Confirm SPV as hostile vehicle. You know what to do.
Don't worry, Lieutenant. We'll stop it.
Jackanory. People queued up to tell a story on Jackanory. Even Prince Charles appeared once. Here are some other famous names.
Moray Mill, I hear you cry.
All right. Thank you, Your Majesty. The King asked the Queen, and the Queen asked the dairymaid.
Could we have some butter for the royal slice of bread?
The Queen asked the dairymaid. The dairymaid said,
certainly, I'll go and tell the cow now before she goes to bed.
The dairymaid, she curtsied and went and told the Alderney.
Don't forget the butter for the royal slice of bread.
The Alderney said sleepily,
you better tell His Majesty that many people nowadays like marmalade instead.
The dairymaid said,
fancy,
and went to Her Majesty. She curtsied to the Queen and she turned a little red.
Excuse me, Your Majesty, for taking of the liberty, but marmalade is tasty if it's very thickly spread.
The Queen said,
ooh,
and went to His Majesty.
Talking of the butter for the royal slice of bread, many people think that marmalade is nicer. Would you like to try a little marmalade instead?
The King said,
bother.
And then he said,
oh, dearie me.
The King sobbed.
Oh, dearie me.
And went back to bed.
Nobody.
He whimpered.
Call me a fussy man. I only want a little bit of butter for me bread.
The Queen said,
there, there.
And went to the dairymaid. The dairymaid said,
there, there.
And went to the shed. The cow said,
there, there. I didn't really mean it. Here's milk for his porringer and butter for his bread.
The Queen took the butter and brought it to His Majesty. The King said,
butter, eh?
And bounced out of bed.
Nobody,
he said, as he kissed her tenderly.
Nobody,
he said, as he slid down the banisters.
Nobody, my darling, could call me a fussy man. But I do like a little bit of butter to me bread.
Goodbye.
The 70s were a precarious and a dangerous era. Did you ever wear a pair of these? The fashion of the 70s became the backache of the 80s. Not only did they say you could break your ankle in these, but also in future years they did say that it could hamper childbirth. Children's television discovered pop music in the 70s, although to look at these next few clips you'd never believe it. Also, it discovered colour and fashion. A lot of bands didn't survive, but a few did. Here are some of the many to appear on children's programmes like Liftoff, Shang-A-Lang and Look Alive.
Something to say, shooby-doo, I'm gonna try to tell you that I really love you, shooby-doo, hey, gotta say in my way, it may not be fancy, I know, but I said it before and I'll say it again. Do all of me too.
Oh, oh, I love you so, I can't let you go, don't tell me no, I need your love tonight. Oh, gee, well, the way you kiss, 3D, too good to miss, why, I want more of this, I need your love tonight.
A ship into a bottle. How can you sit on three eggs without breaking them? Those were the sort of questions that were baffling scientists in the 1970s, but the kids knew the answers. Jack Hargreaves, Fred Dinage, they all used to answer the questions for the kids in How.
It's a very old bottle for original Bombay chutney, ship brand. Trouble is that ship into bottle won't go. Secret is this, it is a folding ship. That mast folds back, like that, and all the rigging, which is elongated out to here, goes through little holes, just as if it were going through pulleys, so you can pull it tight. And now, the ship will go in a bottle. And you can hang it down and settle it in the sea. The sea, in this case, is plasticine. That's the modern technique. In the old days, it was plaster of Paris, and you left it there all night, like that, until the ship was firmly set in its plaster of Paris, and then all you had to do was pull. In this case, I have to hold the ship steady with this tool, because otherwise I should pull it out of the plasticine. But if I get hold of the right two things, up it comes, and the ship is in the bottle. Now, that's very simple, isn't it, to see it done like that with the Cornish crabber in the simple wide-neck bottle. But have a look at this. There is a full-rigged ship prepared for pushing into a bottle.
How can you throw a pot?
Well, it's the quickest how I've ever seen you do. What's next?
No, I mean, all right, you've seen a potter and a potter's wheel before. I know that, but I've never ever tried it, and I want to have a go at throwing a pot. I've got my pottery wheel here. I've never had a go before, I promise you, but my good friend Alan White from Pool Pottery has run me through the theory of all this. And I will now show you how you throw a pot. First of all, you need a machine and your lump of clay. And the first thing is getting it on the little disc here is crucial. It must go on with some force. Lubrication is the next thing. You must have lubrication. And what you're trying to do here is get it centralized. And the technique, get the arms and the elbows tight in on your body. Stop the damn thing. So, anyway, that's stage one. And having... this is a half-completed job over here. So you... just got to find my little knobs to get it in. Talk amongst yourself. That's one of them. Now, the technique here, that's it, is having got it more or less in plenty of lubrication, more or less in shape, one hand goes inside. I'm going to now try and raise the pot flat inside, the other hand like so. Marianne, can you spare a minute? I want to show you something. Come across. Hey, I want about that.
You didn't make that. The rubbish. Look at this. What a mess.
That's how you throw a pot.
One for sorrow, two for joy, three for a girl, four for a boy, five for silver, six for gold, seven for a secret never to be told. Thames Television's popular rival to Blue Peter was the long-running Magpie, with such presenters as Mick Robertson, Dougie Ray, Jenny Hanley, and Susan Stranks. One of the most famous annual events was the Christmas Appeal that followed a line all around the Teddington studios.
Well, Mickey, that famous thin red line is really moving fast now across the reception hall. We left you on Tuesday with a total of 27,000 and asked you for a target of £30,355.29. Well, not only have you managed to send in all that money, despite the fact that you're buying lots of Christmas presents, but the line's gone right across the reception hall here, and it's ended up at a total there, a fantastic total of £38,905.19, and we've been able to buy another £8,000 worth of goods, and that really is a super achievement, especially at this time of the year when money is being spent. We're not with you on Tuesday because we're taking a holiday ourselves. There's lots of special ITV programmes, but we are setting another target for a week today, £42,499.19, to get on with all the central heating.
Take a matchbox, and Jenny, I'll need your help for this one, eh, please. Take a matchbox and you shake it in front of them.
Very good.
Say, now, is that matchbox full or is it empty?
It's full, I heard them rattle.
You're wrong, it's empty, I'll just prove it to you.
Believe it!
An empty matchbox, you see.
How do you do that?
The trick is that I have another matchbox that is full, hidden up my sleeve. You see, and that one makes the noise.
I'll show you one. I can command a matchbox to do what I want.
Oh, really?
You're impressed?
Yes.
We might be.
I will
now,
be.
Now, I want it to land face up, with the name up, right?
Okay.
I command you to land name up. How about that?
It worked. That's
to prove
fantastic.
It's not a fluke, I command you to land with the face up.
That's incredible. This is going to stop people going to sleep, isn't it, on
That's
Christmas
true.
Day?
That's true.
Fantastic.
The thing is, I feel out to show you how it's done.
Oh, yes.
Don't you think?
Yes,
well, actually, underneath here, is a coin to weight it down?
I thought it really was magic.
Wurzel Gummidge, written by Willis Hall and Keith Waterhouse and starring John Pertwee and Eunice Dubs as Aunt Sally. This was one of the most famous serials on ITV.
Here, you finished tangling with that there cooking machine, Aunt Sally?
For the time being, I might boil myself some eggs after breakfast. We shall have to see.
You'll set your head on fire one of these days, and then you'll know all about it. Hey, Aunt Sally, are you going to eat all these sausages yourself?
Yes, I am. And keep your thieving hands off. And when you watch me have my breakfast, you go down to the village and get me some more sausages and some more cream cakes and some more chocolate. There's some money in the thing over there.
We'll see.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that little mushroom. Mm. It's funny, isn't it? Them going away and leaving all their money behind in a little mushroom. There's enough money in here to buy another 11 to 3 breakfast.
Just shows how rich and wealthy they are. We rich and wealthy folk don't care about money. We just leave it lying about.
Yeah. Where are they gone to for their holidays, Aunt Sally?
Who cares? Bulgaria, probably. That's where all the fashionable people go nowadays.
Yes, yeah, so I've heard. Does come back to one after eruptions if they find us here.
What does it matter? Stupid scarecrow! We'll hear them coming back!
Oh, that's right. They went in the motor car, didn't they?
Right. So we'll hear the motor car coming back.
Well, I think I'll take this here mushroom down the village shop and buy you some more sausages and cream cake.
And I'll get dressed in a minute and put some more rouge on my pretty face.
Zippy, George and Bungle, the stars of Rainbow, have developed a cult following and the music is in a world of its own.
I had a horse, the horse was brown. Rode him in the country, rode him in the town. Rode him in the woodland, rode him down the lane. Rode him by the river and back again. Riding fast, riding slow, over the hills and the fields we go. Well, I had a cottage and rode him back. Rode him in the wood and rode him in the lane. Rode him down the valley and back again.
Riding fast, riding slow, over the hills and the fields we go.
I'm looking at a horse from our farm.
Clip-clop, 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 clip-clop.
What do you mean, clip-clop, clip-clop? That's the sound of the horse's feet, isn't it, Bungle? Walking along the road.
Yes, I'm pretending to be a horse. Will you be one as well?
Clip-clop, 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 clip-clop.
Now a bit faster. Trot, 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 trot. Now I'm going to gallop as fast as I can. Gallop, a gallop, a gallop, a gallop, a gallop, a gallop, a gallop.
Whoops!
I'm galloping like a horse. But it's hard work galloping. Oh, what are you doing on the floor?
What am I doing on... I was knocked down, Buckle, by a galloping horse.
Oh, dear. Uh-huh.
Take any notice of those bears, Willie. Damn it, boys and girls. That was jolly good. I thought that was very good indeed, and they're just being naughty. They're jealous. Oh, he's off again. Lovely. Yeah. Yes. Very, very, oh, tremolo. Oh, very good, Willie, indeed. Yes, afraid we've had this all day. And since you are so wide awake today, Willie Wombat, you better say hello to the boys and girls. Go on.
Hello. Hi, was just blowing and making some music. We thought you were making a row. Thought you were strangling Katie.
When it was on, Playaway was another programme with a huge adult fan club. Witty and musical, and watch out for Baldric actor Tony Robinson and heartthrob Jeremy Irons in these extracts.
Now, the ladies of the harem of the court of King Caractacus were just passing by. Yes, the ladies of the harem of the court of King Caractacus were just passing by. Yes, the ladies of the harem of the court of King Caractacus were just passing by. Yes, the ladies of the harem of the court of King Caractacus were just passing by.
Now the noses on the faces of the ladies in the harem in the court of King Caractacus were just passing by. Now the noses on the faces of the ladies in the harem in the court of King Caractacus were just passing by. Now the noses on the faces of the ladies in the harem in the court of King Caractacus were just passing by. Now the noses on the faces of the ladies in the harem in the court of King Caractacus were just passing by.
Now the boys who put the powder on the noses of the faces of the ladies of the harem in the court of King Caractacus were just passing by. Now the boys who put the powder on the noses of the faces of the ladies in the harem of the court of King Caractacus were just passing by. Now the boys who put the powder on the noses of the faces of the ladies in the harem of the court of King Caractacus were just passing by. Now the boys who put the powder on the noses of the faces of the ladies in the harem of the court of King Caractacus were just passing by.
Now those
fascinating witches who put scintillating stitches in the bridges of the boys who put the powder on the noses of the faces of the ladies in the harem in the court of King Caractacus. We're just passing by now. The fascinating witches who put scintillating stitches in the bridges of the boys who put the powder on the noses of the faces of the ladies in the harem in the court of King Caractacus. We're just passing by now. The fascinating witches who put scintillating stitches in the bridges of the boys who put the powder on the noses of the faces of the ladies in the harem in the court of King Caractacus. We're just passing by now. The fascinating witches who put scintillating stitches in the bridges of the boys who put the powder on the noses of the faces of the ladies in the harem in the court of King Caractacus. We're just passing by.
Now, if you want to take some pictures of the fascinating witches who put scintillating stitches in the bridges of the boys who put the powder on the noses of the faces of the ladies of the harem of the court of King Caractacus.
You're too late, dear.
Oh, they just passed by.
Roll up, roll up for the two of the kind game. Everything in pairs. Fast pair, please.
We're a pair.
We're a pair. What are we a pair of?
A pair of kippers.
We're a pair.
We're a pair. We're what a pair. Are we a pair of?
A pair of slippers.
We're a pair.
We're a pair.
What are we a pair of?
We're a pair of knickers.
Ladies and gentlemen, the great Anne-Marie will now amaze you all by juggling with an elephant.
Wait a minute. I can't juggle with an elephant.
Can't you? Why not?
I'll need two.
Now then, tell me, what has eight legs, two wings, and two arms?
I don't know, Brian. What has eight legs, two wings, and two arms?
A man on a horse carrying a canary. Tweet, tweet.
Tweet.
Stop flapping about, dear.
I say.
Oh, yes.
What has four legs and flies?
Oh, we don't know. What has four legs and flies?
Two pairs of trousers.
Oh, what a zippy joke.
I say. How do you start a flea race?
We don't know. How do you start a flea race?
One, two, flee away.
It really doesn't matter if it's raining or it's fine, just as long as you've got time to play. Play away, way, play away, play, play away, way, play.
Play school continued with very few changes in the 70s. We were still going through the windows and still looking under the clock.
Jelly and meringues.
Thank you.
wonder if this jelly is set enough to come out now. It's not the one I made earlier. I made this quite a long time ago because, well, it takes quite a while for jellies to set. This is a green jelly. Do you think it'll come out? Let's see. Give it a good shake. Well, something's happening. Can you see anything? Well, it wobbles about, and that's the main thing.
Getting wobbler and wobblier. No, I've got to get more jellier. Jellier with me. Come on, wobble your hands. Wobble wrists, elbows, and feet, and ankles.
Hips and tummy, wobble the lot.
I wish I could wobble like my sister Kate. She wobbles like a jelly on a plate. Just like a jelly, you can wobble with me. Wobble your elbows and wobble your knees. Wobble, shake and shiver from head to toe. Wobble, shake and shiver wherever you go. Jelly for breakfast, jelly for tea. So wibble, wobble, wibble with me.
Jelly for breakfast and jelly for tea. So wibble, wobble, wibble, wibble, wobble, wibble, wibble, wobble, wibble with me. Did you wobble? Well, look, I've got something else here that wobbles. You have a look. Here you will find the deep blue sea. This is a boat. This is me. All the silver fishes down below wiggle their tails and off they go. You ever seen the sea? Perhaps you live at the seaside, or perhaps you've been there for a holiday. Well, there's the sea through one of our windows today. It's a very quiet part of the coast, very rocky. There aren't any houses there, and people don't visit it very often. We'll see it through the watery window, so come and look.
Thames Television produced some excellent children's drama in the 1970s. Here are clips from some of their output, and watch out for The Landlord of the Rover's Return in Pardon My Genie.
Jet white dove, snow black snake, time is fair tales. From the edge of mystery, where running is no race. Ages high, colors fade, wave reaches out a hand to touch the edge of destiny, a story with no
thank you. Tim, I want a complete rundown of all UFO sightings for the period we're concerned with.
Check.
Let's start near home. Were any of them seen over London?
Only one.
When was that recorded?
Approximately 12 months before the start of the period you're concerned with.
And was that the only one?
According to my records, yes. But the sighting is unconfirmed. I have only local newspaper reports.
I'm sure it's the cussing.
At least two eyewitnesses are able to swear that last night they saw a flying saucer hovering over Kingston on the River Thames.
Goodbye, Spain. It's been nice knowing you.
My God, it's one of the George, don't your life.
Sure, it could make life easier for Mr. Cobblick. You know, if he wants to be honest and truthful, I think we should help him.
Oh, Mandarin of the Muffins and Caliph of the Crumpets, nothing could be simpler. From this moment forth, the Cobblick shall tell nothing but the truth.
Great. After all, if Mr. Cobblick tells nothing but the truth, he can't get into any trouble, can he?
No, Master.
Yahoo! Naughty, naughty! Why are you always avoiding me, Mr...
Well, I'm frightened you might ask me about the cake you gave me.
Why didn't you want me to ask you about the cake?
Because I'm using it as a doorstop.
You beast! How could you, Mr. Cobbledick?
You've remembered my name.
I assure you, I'll never forget it as long as my name is...
There must be some mistake, Mr.
There's
Sibley.
No mistake! I've just seen my poor mother in the street crying her eyes out because that bully Cobbledick insulted her. I'll tear him limb from limb.
Oh, if he finds me, he'll kill me.
I'll pulverize him. I'll pulverize him. I'll break his jaw. Cobbledick, where are you?
I'm down here hiding behind the counter.
No, Mr. Sibley, calm down, please.
Get out of my way.
Stephen, it's true. He really did bury my biscuits.
Oh,
I walked round to the backyard just now to have a look-see. And there it was, a little mound of fresh earth.
Oh, dear.
So, that's how you pay my mother's kindness. You ungrateful oaf!
I didn't mean it.
Don't you treat my boss like that.
Dreadful.
All right, that's enough for that now.
Get him, Mr. Cobblepot.
Hold him, Hal. Hold him.
Verily, my master and the others seem strangely excited. It seems the food hath gone to their heads.
And my. There was an almighty battle going on Saturday mornings in the 1970s. Who was watching Swap Shop and who was watching Tiswas?
Now, at 9:30, Swap Shop.
S-W-A-P, S-H-O-P, it's a Swap Shop!
Swap Shop!
Hello! Very good morning to you. Got so much to pack into this programme, we're really going to have to move. So I'll give you some idea of... Somebody, it's Michael in Giffnot. He's still got his pyjamas on. Come on, out of the room, up to the bedroom, change. We're not having any... Michael in Giffnot, out. It's Michael Patterson, out. Go on, upstairs. Not having anybody sitting around with pyjamas on. Got an awful lot to get through. Alison Brown's written to me. She's in Clashendrum near... Inverbervie, and she says, I've got a problem at school. My name's Alison Brown, I'm 11 years old, I'm very small, and I'm also very often teased at school. The only thing is that last Saturday, it wasn't me who phoned Lulu about her height, so would you please tell everybody in Inverbervie that it wasn't me who phoned you, but somebody else. Yours, Alison Brown. Things for you all right about. Denise says, could you please play the old Swap Shop signature tune as my friend Elizabeth Jane Avery can't remember what it sounded like.
Well, it was sort of swap shop, which is why we've got a new one.
Your little jumper, by the way, it's really nice, that.
My little jumper? It's not a jumper,
well,
it's
well,
just...
little
thing. That wasn't what you said a few moments ago, Keith.
I know, I just thought I'd be nice to him this morning for a change.
Anyway, it's taken us an awful long time to get to where we are today. In fact, it's taken 5 hours, hasn't it?
But funny enough, while we were on the train coming down from the swap shop studio, we discovered that we've both been to this part of the world on holiday. And it's quite funny to think that it was probably him who kicked in my sandcastle.
It was probably you who nicked my beach ball and nicked my ice cream cornet and all the things like that.
Now, would I do a thing like that, Keith?
I think you would, Maggie. Hi, what would you like Tony to draw?
A giraffe for my birthday.
A giraffe?
A giraffe for your birthday? We'd better put the paper another this, way, this way around. Yes, we can always add to it. I think you'll get... Righto, giraffe coming up.
Is it your birthday today?
No, it's tomorrow.
Tomorrow. Well, happy birthday for tomorrow. How old will you be? How old will you be?
8.
You'll be 8. Very good. Well, you have an extra little present here.
8 years old.
What do you like about giraffes? Why do you
they're
want a giraffe?
They're my favourite animals and they're so cool that I like them.
Yes, they're excellent things. I'd love to have a giraffe, actually. It'd be very useful. Cleaning upstairs windows.
That's a very good idea, isn't it? Look, this giraffe is so high up, it's coming out of the clouds. Can you see the clouds at the bottom? I didn't catch your name, old thing. What? Who are you?
Ian Mack.
Ian. I-A-N.
Yes.
Happy. I put happy, but I'll do it again and send it down. Happy birthday, Ian. There you are. Your giraffe is eating leaves from a great height. One of the.
Thank
you. Very good.
The happier birthday is sprouting leaves. Ian, would you like to carry on putting the spots in when you get it?
Yes.
Righto.
Happy birthday for tomorrow, Ian. Thanks for calling us.
Bye.
Eric. Thank you, Eric. If we could just have the swaps in. Hasn't changed his socks, has he?
No, right. Now, this is the Terry... You're dead right, actually. They're the same socks.
Yeah, the same socks.
You got the same socks on that you wore last time Tony was here.
Oh, dear. Right, could you have a delve?
Yeah.
Can you reach in there?
It's not easy. So.
But I don't understand why Sally James never gets a custard pie.
I do.
Well, I think we can clear that up. So now, I've got another one here from Billy Thorpe of Woolpit. Now, he says, could you please do me a favour, Chris? I thoroughly enjoy the show. I like Algernon Razzmatazz. Who is the Phantom Flampling? He says, a big PS at the end. But why doesn't Sally James get enough custard pie? Do I think fairly strange. So that's you done, Billy. As you know, on this programme, we try and help people. Tony West from Liverpool's with me.
Running,
last week, Chris had a lot of spaghetti poured over him. I love things like that. But it would please me much more if Sally J. Well, I think we can arrange that. That shouldn't be any problem. So that's for little Tony West from Liverpool. Now, Will Pitt here from Dudley, he writes in saying, I don't like the bits where Sally James always seems to run out of the way when the muck's coming in. Can you give her a bucket of baked beans? Wow, it's a dark dog. You've had a lot of people writing in about baked beans. This is also for Nora Niceness of Netherton, and also Algernon Sphinx from Utoctita, and also Clarissa Clutterbuck from Carlisle. And they all wanted the baked beans. Now, Semolina got a lot of mail as well. David McKellar. Morning, David. Sorry I didn't ring you last night in Cardiff. The phone was a bit funny. No, he said, whatever you do, don't pour Semolina over Sally. Well, not to worry, we've done that one.
Oh, yeah.
Very old. There are a lot of people there who have written in saying, can they have semolina?
Can I have some water?
Nigel Baverstock.
Water, please.
Yes, in a minute. It'll be our pleasure. Nigel Baverstock of Liverpool says, I'd like to see semolina, a whole bucket of semolina, thrown out of from close range. Well, I think we can manage that without any problem at all. Great. Well, there you are. That's just caught up on a bit of your mail. Thanks very much. Keep the mail rolling in, especially if it's things like that. I don't know who that's from, but she's obviously very grateful anyway. We leave you with Algernon, Winston, Spencer, Castlereagh, Razzmatazz's classic, the OK song. Take it away, Algernon.
That was our trip down the memory lane of children's television in the 1970s, and I hope it brought back some memories. You can relive the joys of other children's television programmes on our other two videos, The Best of Children's TV in the 60s and in the 1980s. I'll leave you with one of my favourites from the 70s, a complete episode of The Wombles.
Ground, overground, wombling free. The wombles of Wimbledon, common are we. Making good use of the things that we find. Things that the everyday folks leave behind.
This is the home of the wombles, on a bright, sunny day. Even Great Uncle Bulgaria has decided to sit in the sun.
Yes, I shall read my newspaper out of doors today. Yes, good heavens, look at that. Yes, goodness, I must check with my stockbroker.
The other wombles are hard at work, even Orinoco.
Tidy up this and tidy up that, it's all we ever do. Oh, dear me. Let's see. Oh, hello, what's this? It's a nice bit of material. It's all dark in there then. Yes. Slip it on here. It's a bit on the large side, perhaps. Still, it'll be nice and warm in the winter. Look at that. Got a pair of boots. Yes. One boot, two boot. Yes, I bet Roger Kipling left these here. Yes, you get a pair of boots and a coat like this, and what have you got? What have you got? You watch. You've got the largest womble in the world.
Here, Bungo, have you seen Orinoco?
No, perhaps he's gone back to the burrow. Good morning, Bungo.
Who said that?
Good morning, Tomsk.
Hey?
I said, good morning, young wombles.
Yeah.
Good morning, young wombles. And where are your manners?
It's a human being, and he's seen us.
Yeah, but it's worse than that, Bungo. He knows our names. What are we gonna do? Well, just say good morning. Say good morning, human. Human. Oh yeah, human. I take a morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Goodbye. Goodbye.
Uncle Bulgaria. Uncle Bulgaria. Listen, it's a big, enormous human being. It was as big as that. It was bigger. Bigger. Yeah. And he knew our names. He called me Bungo. Did he? No. Called you Bungo, did he?
Yes, there he is over there, look.
Yes, it appears to me, Bungo, that there are now two persons on that bench.
That was a terrific joke. Who are the people? I mean, it's a person, and it's a real one. Look at that. He tried to kick me. Try to kick me then. Come on back. Let's get out of here. Come on. Shh. Don't rustle. Don't rustle, tiny man. Come on.
Ah, Orinoco. Well, I must... You look quite exhausted, Orinoco. Have you had a very busy time?
Oh, very, yes, and I'm feeling a bit hungry now.
Yes, well, I see there are still some old clothes by that bench. Now, when that person moves, would you go and tidy those things up, young Womble?
Yes, but great Uncle Bulgaria.
Well, I mean, as soon as supper is over.
Oh, yes, great Uncle Bulgaria, yes. I must have my supper first, because I was the largest Womble in the world, so I must have the largest appetite.
Wombling free, the Wombles of Wimbledon, come on, are we? Underground, overground, Wombling free. The Wombles of Wimbledon, common are we, making good use of the things that we find.